Soil is our life support system. Soils provide anchorage for roots, hold water, and nutrients. Soils are home to a myriad of microorganisms that fix nitrogen and decompose organic matter, and armies of microscopic animals, as well as earthworms and termites. We build on soil as well as with it and in it. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video will provide a general introduction to soil, including the history of using it for agriculture, its functions, its uses, soil health, and its effect on climate. Most early civilization in the Old World grew and thrived on the rich soil and waters of major river floodplains. Early Chinese culture began to develop 6,000 to 7,000 years ago on floodplains of the Yellow River, where periodic flooding deposited fresh soil for agriculture and canals could carry irrigation water. The same is true in the Mideast. Greek historian Herodotus left us notes about the dependence of Egypt on soil supplied by flooding of the Nile. He noted in 340 BC that he observed that black, crumbly, silty river deposits were easy to work and productive. These soils could produce plentiful food with less toil. In North America, part of its success stands on rich soil and water resources, but we have not always been wise in their use. The Dust Bowl of the 1930s, caused by drought, soil misuse, and wind erosion, drove farmers out of several Middle Plains states. With the population increasing, soil will become more crucial, including conserving what we have. Soil is a thin interface between the atmosphere at 22 miles deep and the rocky solid surface of the continental crust about 50 miles thick. The atmosphere, crust, and soil interact to provide plants and animals with the resources they need. Living things need proper temperature, oxygen, water, carbon, and other nutrients. Plant roots grow best in certain soil temperature ranges, usually above 40 to 50 degrees Fahrenheit. Soil maintains temperatures for growing plants and exchanges energy. Plant roots and other microorganisms need oxygen and give off carbon dioxide as they respire. Water cycles through evaporation, then precipitation. Water seeps deep into the ground where it is held as groundwater or temporarily stored for plant use. Plants filter water, purifying it as it moves through the soil. Plant leaves collect sunlight to use the sun's energy for photosynthesis, converting atmospheric carbon, carbon dioxide, to biological carbon, simple sugars. That carbon is recycled back to the atmosphere by plant and animal respiration or organic matter decay. Plant nutrients also cycle through the soil through the nitrogen and other mineral cycles. Nitrogen comes from the atmosphere as a gas and is converted by soil organisms to forms that plants can use. Other nutrients are released from rocks in the Earth's crust when rocks are broken down by weather, plants, and other factors. An individual plant depends on soil for four needs: anchorage, water, oxygen, and nutrients. In deep soil, where roots grow freely, plants are formally supported or anchored so they can grow to reach for sunlight. When people grow plants in ways that deprive plants of soil support, artificial support is often required. Because roots are a plant's water-absorbing body, soil supplies the water a plant uses. For each pound of dry matter produced by growth, plants obtain between 200 and 1,000 pounds of water from the soil for photosynthesis, sap flow, and other uses. It is obvious that water-holding capacity of a soil is important in its agricultural and horticultural use. Except for some microscopic organisms, all living creatures, including plants, need oxygen. Plants release oxygen during photosynthesis but consume it during respiration. Of 17 nutrients usually considered to be needed by most plants, plants absorb 14 from soil. Carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen come from air and water. The rest are from the soil. Nitrogen comes indirectly from the atmosphere via the soil. While leaves are able to absorb some nutrients, roots are specialized for the purpose. As part of the nitrogen cycle, soil harbors microorganisms and nitrogen-fixing bacteria that convert nitrogen to plant-usable forms. Most of the gas and air in soil is nitrogen. Above the soil, air is about 21% oxygen. In the soil, respiration of living things replaces oxygen with carbon dioxide. As a result, soil air has less oxygen and more carbon dioxide than the atmosphere. The resulting concentration gradients between soil and atmosphere causes oxygen to diffuse into the soil and carbon dioxide to diffuse out. In the absence of factors that limit it, this process, known as soil aeration, exchanges soil and atmospheric air to maintain adequate oxygen for plant roots. Aeration varies according to soil condition. Saturated or waterlogged soil, which is completely soaked with water, is an example of a soil with poor aeration. The oxygen content near the surface of a well-aerated soil rarely drops below 20%, but it may approach zero in a saturated soil. How does soil fulfill the functions described? Any grower knows that soil is made of solid particles. In most soils, solid particles largely consist of mineral matter with about 1% to 10% organic material. Between these solid particles are open spaces or voids, which we call pore spaces. This arrangement of solid particles and pore spaces is called the soil matrix. Commonly, about half the volume of soil is solid material with some combination of air and water, ideally equal proportions. A large pore may be rich in oxygen, while a small pore, a fraction of an inch away, contains water and is devoid of oxygen. Those large pores, called macropores or aeration pores, are largely responsible for easy movement of air and water in the soil, and for providing space for air, while smaller micropores retain water for plant use. Generally, soil is richest in oxygen near the surface, while deeper layers may be very low in oxygen because the atmosphere is farther away and pathways for diffusion are much longer. This in turn influences distribution of roots in soil. Plants need a sufficient volume of quality water to host roots and supply needed resources. The photo shows two rows of urban trees. The row on the left was planted in small tree pits surrounded by pavement. The trees are stunted. The row on the right, planted at the same time, enjoys open soil where roots have room to grow. The trees are much larger and darker green. From a root's point of view, it is pores that matter. As roots grow into the soil, they follow continuous pore spaces between solid particles, absorbing water and nutrients from the soil solution. Root tips easily penetrate pores larger than themselves. Behind the root tip, the diameter of the root increases, pushing aside or deforming the soil to make room for itself. Root tips may also enter smaller pores if the root can exert enough pressure to deform soil ahead of the tip. If pores are too small or discontinuous, or if soil particles are too difficult to push aside, root growth suffers. Such conditions can result if soil is severely compressed or compacted. In such soil, roots may only be able to follow cracks or other channels in the soil. Water reaches roots in two ways. Either water flows toward the root, or the root grows into moist soil. Plant roots spread far from the plant, seeking water and nutrients. Most roots spread literally near the soil surface where the oxygen content is highest. For trees, they typically extend up to three times the spread of the canopy. One authority estimated that a mature oak tree has about 1 million live root tips. A few plants, like alfalfa, send roots deep into the soil. Alfalfa roots grow to a depth of 5 or 6 feet and may go much deeper in loose soils. However, roots do not grow below the depth of aeration unless they are specially adapted to do so. So most roots do not extend below 5 or 6 feet. Some soils have hard layers under the surface called hard pans, which prevent roots from growing deeply. As a result, the plant has less soil to draw on for soil and nutrients. The same effect results from bedrock or waterlogged soil near the surface. Human societies depend on soil to grow food, fiber, timber, ornamental plants, and increasingly biofuels. Cropland is land on which soil is worked and crops are planted, cared for, and harvested. Worldwide, the greatest acreage of cropland is devoted to annual crops, those planted and harvested within one growing season. Annual crops include agronomic products such as corn and soybeans, fiber plants such as cotton, and horticultural crops such as vegetables. Annuals require yearly soil preparation. Because the soil surface is often bare much of the time, growers must be careful to keep soil from washing away, and repeated tillage degrades soil and water. Perennial forages, such as alfalfa, are in the ground for a few years. They may be harvested as hay to feed animals or be used for grazing. These crops cover the soil completely and so keep the soil from washing away. Perennial crops tend to build up and improve the soil and are better than annuals for maintaining or enriching soil organic matter. Perennial horticultural crops include fruits, nuts, and nursery stock. Plants stay in the ground for 3 to as many as 20 years. Many crops are clean cultivated to keep the ground bare and weed-free, while others are grown on sod or other soil cover. Challenges to the grower of such horticultural crops are controlling weeds, reducing erosion, preventing soil compaction, and keeping organic matter levels stable. Much land in the United States is grazed by cattle and sheep. Range consists of largely of native grasses and shrubs, while some non-native grasses planted through existing vegetation. Partly because of the size of much rangeland, it is usually loosely managed. The environmental consequences of grazing depend largely on how land is managed. Overstocked land suffers damage to soil and water. Proper grazing practices can be quite sustainable. Foresters probably disturb soil the least, but soil management is still a concern. When trees are harvested after many years' growth, logging equipment tears up the vegetative cover and compacts the soil. Increased erosion results, and the soil is a less desirable medium for growth of newly planted seedlings. In landscape horticulture, landscapers install and maintain plants in soils that have often been heavily modified by construction. Their activities conserve soil in urban areas, but until a landscape project is complete, soil erosion can be severe. In recent years, efforts to make construction greener and more sustainable have become more prominent through leadership in energy and environmental design, LEED certification. There is increasing interest in growing food in or very near cities. This urban agriculture or urban farming is something greater than small-scale gardening, but different than typical rural commercial production. Urban farming seeks to provide food, especially for poorer people, near where it will be consumed. Other human activities, in addition to growing plants, require soils. Recreational uses of the soil surface are important. Golf courses, parks, and campgrounds are examples of large areas used for recreation. The design of recreational facilities is a specialized skill that requires knowledge of soil properties. Sport playing fields may be the most demanding of all soil uses. To grow turf that withstands the punishment of football cleats or soccer shoes challenges even the best of managers. Before constructing a home, laying a road, or installing sewer lines, soils must be tested and sometimes modified to make sure that they are suitable for supporting the structure. Examples of important engineering properties include shrink swell potential and load-bearing capacity. Treatment of human sanitary waste often relies on soil because it filters out some of the material while microorganisms break down organic portions into less dangerous compounds. One way for sewage treatment plants to handle their end products is to spread them on soil. Sewage sludge may be useful to farmers as a source of nutrients and organic matter as long as possible harmful materials in the sludge are taken into account. Before long-distance shipping of building materials became practical, people built their homes with locally available materials, including soil. Adobe, a sun-baked mixture of three-part sandy soil to one-part clay soil, has been used as a building material for thousands of years and continues to be used in the American Southwest. The figure on the slide shows how non-federal land was used in 2007, but land use does not remain static. In any given year, some forest is cleared for cropland, while somewhere else cropland returns to forest. Market forces such as land or grain prices, technological change such as irrigation, and government programs spur changes in land use. About 80% of non-federal land is evenly divided among crop, forest, and rangelands as the major uses of our soils. One land use continues to grow at the expense of other uses, urbanization. This includes the building of cities, towns, factories, and roads. Soil quality, also called soil health, is the capacity of a specific soil to provide needed functions for human or natural ecosystems over the long term. That is, it can sustain plant and animal growth and productivity, maintain air and water quality, and support human health. Quality soil helps keep a forest healthy and grows excellent crops or effective landscapes. Soil degradation is the loss of soil quality. Because soil connects intimately to water, soil degradation also means soil quality problems. Examples of soil and water degradation include water erosion of soil from the land, particularly a problem in the eastern half of the country, wind erosion of soil from the land, particularly a problem in the western half of the country, pollution by industrial chemicals, oil spills, and many others, conversion of dry grasslands to desert called desertification, changes in soil chemistry such as severe changes in soil acidity, increases in soil salt levels or salinization, a common problem in California and the American Southwest, and loss of soil organic matter. While preserving soil and water quality involves understanding basic soil processes and management, It also includes specific practices that preserve our soil and water resources while being practical and profitable for our soil user. We call these practices best management practices, BMPs. For example, an entire set of BMPs involve practices that keep the soil covered as much as possible, employing management methods such as mulching, cover cropping, or conservation tillage. Conservation tillage dramatically reduces erosion and polluting runoff, stores more moisture in the field, and improves soil organic matter content without being difficult or expensive. The photo shows a BMP for capturing runoff from residential settings before it can enter lakes or streams, called a rain garden. Soil also plays a critical role in natural ecosystems. For instance, which living things reside where depends on soil and climate, because these two define availability of resources such as proper temperature, moisture, and nutrients. In a local area, water and nutrients largely control the nature of plant communities, and it is soil that delivers those resources. The figure shows an ordination diagram of wooded communities in Minnesota. Each colored patch represents a group of related plant communities. Each code represents a specific community. Note the axis of the diagram. Moisture level and nutrient availability both strongly influenced by soil. Our changing global climate will affect growers and other soil users in ways we are only beginning to understand. Climate affects how we use the soil, and in turn, how we use the soil affects the climate. Soils interact with the atmosphere by gas exchange. Some of these gases are greenhouse gases, or gases that trap heat in the atmosphere, such as carbon dioxide. What we do when we manage soil can increase or decrease concentration of these gases in the atmosphere, and thus the degree of climate change. According to 2007 data, the agricultural sector contributes about 6% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. Soil is one of the planet's largest reservoirs of carbon in the form of organic matter. If we lose soil organic matter from fields, more carbon dioxide goes into the atmosphere and climate change is promoted. If we increase soil organic matter, carbon dioxide is withdrawn from the atmosphere and climate change is moderated. In practical terms, for instance, modern conservation tillage increases soil organic matter, while older conventional tillage reduces it. Or because land covered with permanent grass cover holds more organic matter than land growing corn and soybeans, converting more animal production from feed to grazing or forage will also withdraw carbon from the atmosphere. The photo shows a soil in Minnesota that stored large amounts of new carbon after the land was converted to permanent grass cover as part of the Conservation Reserve Program, visible as the deep black coloration of the topsoil. The process of storing carbon in soil, plants, or elsewhere is called carbon sequestration, and locations where it is sequestered are carbon sinks. Agricultural and horticultural lands offer great potential as carbon sinks. Most of the virgin lands of the world were brought under cultivation in the 19th and 20th centuries, causing large losses of soil organic matter and contributing to atmospheric carbon dioxide levels. Soil management with an eye towards carbon sequestration could put some of that back. Natural ecosystems, in contrast, remain largely in equilibrium with atmospheric carbon dioxide, so they cannot store much more carbon. Disturbing them, however, releases lots of carbon dioxide. In summary, the significance of soil is best explained by describing its function in three ways. First, soil serves ecological functions that support life on Earth, including supporting plant growth, recycling, and storing carbon and nutrients, and purifying air and water. Second, soil supplies anchorage, water, and nutrients to the plant and oxygen to roots. Third, people inhabit the soil surface and have both agricultural and non-agricultural uses for soil. Public expectations of soil users may rightfully grow more complex to not only grow crops, but also to preserve soil and water quality by the use of BMPs to grow fuels for the nation and to grow carbon in their soils to moderate climate change.